Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Ramon and you might know me from a content page that I run called Bold Like a Leopard, which it contains a lot of opinions, mostly by me. There's a couple other people that work on it, but I'd like to tell you today about something I'm very excited about, one thing that I've been working on for a while in terms of research, and I've already made a separate page for it, and I'm going to start sharing content on it and maybe even presentations. And it started off a little as a joke, but the deeper I got into it, the more I liked it and the more I had a passion for continuing it, regardless of the events of the past year. And I think if you are somebody watching and you have an opinion either way, you could probably develop an interest in this. And you know, the only thing that I ask is that you start to just develop your own curiosity about a topic that I just find very interesting. I call it the William J. and Hillary R. Clinton Presidential Penitentiary Library. And yeah, it's kind of, I can't even say it with a straight face. And basically it's a bookcase I have in my living room. And I started reading from the first book that I bought about President Clinton, called No One Left to Lie To, which unfortunately I've lent out, so I'm not going to be able to show it on screen today. But the other ones that I've read, I have right next to me, and the one I'm reading right now. And before I start, I want to talk a little about my motivation for doing this. So if you grew up in the 1990s, and you were watching In Living Color, or Mad TV, or Saturday Night Live, or even Arsenio Hall, which was one of the more famous appearances by him, Bill Clinton was probably the celebrity in chief, even though he was the president of the United States. He was very deep in the culture of our country. It was a very free time. The Cold War was already over. And for good or bad, he was somebody who was he just drew a lot of attention compared to President Bush, the elder, who was the president that I was probably seven when he left office, six or seven. And it was a very interesting time to get a new president that was a lot younger than President Bush. He was a lot more photogenic. And would go and I remember there was a thing where he would jog to McDonald's and shit like that. And you know, it was a heady time. And you know, obviously I'm going to get through the other issues that are with President Clinton, because I'm going to be talking about them with the literature that I've been reading over the past few months. So another question you might ask, is this just because you hate Bill Clinton? Well, I don't hate Bill Clinton necessarily. I mean, even if I did, what difference does it make? There are a lot of people more powerful than a guy who writes things from his laptop in the Midwest. There's a lot more people powerful that have a grudge against Bill and Hillary Clinton. I'm not going to make it no bones about it. I do hate Hillary Clinton. I think she's a total bitch. But I'm fair about my criticism with her, and I do the research. There's one thing I would like to augment. I'll see if I have. I mean, there's all the time in the world to do this. I haven't read their actual autobiographies, mostly because I heard they suck. But you know, if I'm going to be completely fair, I might have to at one point read at least a couple of their own books, and to complete the library, I don't know if it's going to necessarily be a matter of fairness, but of consistency, just to include some of their own material. The problem is that I don't really want to contribute any money to their fortune, so it would have to be from some like crummy secondhand bookstore that sells their shit for like, you know, $1.50 or something. But I'm getting off on a tangent there. And then another question you would have, is this politically motivated? Well, I'm very much against the Clinton agenda, but the Clinton agenda isn't very clear politically. There's a lot of issues that they have, both of them, as Christopher Hitchens, who was a left-wing critic of theirs, would say. He doesn't know what they really believe because they don't practice the things that they preach. And therefore, is this politically motivated? Well, let's look at another criticism you could have of me is, why am I not doing the same thing for President Bush? Now, one of the things that I'd say in response is that President Bush, I am very critical of. I don't think he was a good president by any means. I think he was actually very incompetent. A lot of the things he did were pretty unethical too. The attorney issue, it was very murky. I don't know if you can really square that with the way the Justice Department is supposed to work. I was living out of the country for a lot of his term. So it could be ignorance on my part, and I'm not going to make any claims that I'm unbiased. But I did make a little evaluation. I can't say that's complete because it's off of a couple websites and whatever. But how much literature do you think is really published about these two presidents, the Clintons, compared to other presidents and whatever? Let's think about it. With Bush, I counted on Wikipedia's list page, which I'm not saying that that's authoritative, but there were 51 books that are against George Bush. There's 10 that were in favor of him by other biographers. There were 4 books that were attributed to him as an author. He probably wrote them in conjunction with a couple other people. Most of these political figures do. There were 15 concerning the elections that he was in as a presidential candidate, 2000 and 2004. There were 18 titles that I couldn't categorize or weren't categorized, and that's a total of 98 different books or films about him. So with the Clintons, the breakdown is a little harder to do because we're talking about two people, and I couldn't find the straight page that was listing Bill's biographies. That's kind of strange for me, but here's the breakdown that I see so far. And you have Hillary has 6 books that she wrote. That would include It Takes a Village and what's the other one that she had? Decision Points, I think it's called. And no, Decision Points, that might have been Bush. Anyway, what was her book? Well, that's irrelevant. She had 6 books that were attributed to her, 12 books that were written by other authors that were sympathetic to her, 47 that were against her, 9 scholarly books concerning her, or maybe they were just studies, published articles in scholarly journals, 47 children's books, I thought that was a little interesting, and 5 toys like coloring books published about her, one of which was kind of a lampooning her. So, and then there's 4 fictional books concerning her. So that was a total of 130. So that just with Hillary Clinton, and I think it overlaps a little with Bill, there's 130 books compared to 98 about George Bush. And there were 4 books by Bill Clinton. And I'd have to go back and look how many books were published as biographies of him, which is strange. It was easier to find a list of the Hillary books. So there you have it. Look, the President of the United States, whatever he does, in many cases, he becomes a cultural figure. There, Ronald Reagan, I think many conservatives, they worship him unfairly. I think he was, you know, for his first term, for example, you could see a lot of important points that he got across, and he changed the trajectory of the way the country was going at the time. But it's wrong to lionize a president, even if it is somewhat justified. Look at what's been done with President Kennedy. The idolization of his memory, it kind of detracts from many of the truths that we know about his family, about the corruption of his election, about the corruption of his dad, Joe Kennedy, about the issues ethically of appointing your own brother attorney general. And that's basically my point is, that we have these presidents, and I'm hoping that we don't do the same mistake with Donald Trump necessarily to just demonize him or to make him into some sort of savior. And I see both of these happening. And I want people to start taking an interest more in the truth of what happens and how to verify it and what these people are about. I think it's very fair that people are posing questions about Trump's history with the sexual assault, for example. Look, I can't go and say just because I voted for somebody that certain allegations against him never occurred. But until those things are legally litigated, I also don't think it's fair to paint them as being attributed to them fully, especially when it happens in such a quick way as with President Trump. Now, with time, if these things don't get brought to court and the accusers still maintain their allegations, you do have to investigate it further, and you do have to cast a judgment on whether, to your knowledge, it is true or not. So with President Clinton, I think you can look at his track record from years and years and years of you know, obviously all the whoring that he did, and you can see that this is his MO. So anyway, I'm going to get into it. The first volume, which I'm not holding up because I don't have it with me, is No One Left to Lie To, which is a book. It was called a pamphlet, actually, less than a book, by Christopher Hitchens, who's a British, originally was a British writer. He immigrated to the United States in the 80s, I believe. And Hitchens, it's called The Triangulations of William Jefferson Clinton. And I think it's a good book to start with. It talks a lot about his ethical policy issues and how, according to Hitchens and his sources within the White House, one of which was Sidney Blumenthal, who is one of the Clintons' inner circle to this day, the real person running the Clinton administration for a number of months was not Bill Clinton at all. It was Dick Morris, who today is known as one of Clinton's most fierce critics, one of his most bitter enemies right now. And a lot of it was to do with the fact that Clinton himself just used to fuck up so badly when it came to public relations, both by giving his wife the role of Medicare, the healthcare system overhaul, which she screwed up pretty catastrophically in terms of presenting it, and also in terms of his issues with covering up his affairs and all of his personal problems, and his lying about the Whitewater issues and everything. So Christopher Hitchens' biography, and I might post videos, and I've already posted past reviews I did on Bolt Like a Leopard on the new library content page. It's a good place to start. The one flaw I want to say, he doesn't use citations. It's mostly from firsthand contact he had with people that worked within the Clinton administration. You'll see a similar pattern with Edward Klein, another author who's written multiple works about Hillary Clinton specifically, and even Barack Obama, that these people rely mostly on sources within the administration. So you have to take it for what it's worth. If you don't believe that they're a credible author, then you're going to have a hard time believing somebody who doesn't cite his sources. And that's a fair, you know, I'm not going to tell you what to believe or what not to believe. I just present the content. On the other hand, if you like quality of writing, if you like his ability to convey points very well, which is that's the skill of Christopher Hitchens. I do a lot of writing. I admire writers more. I'm actually better at writing than I am at making videos. I think Christopher Hitchens' book, which it went through several print editions. That is the best book to start from, and it is the book that I did start from. And it started me on the path to asking questions. Who really pulled the strings behind that White House? Was it really Hillary Clinton? Or was it also these just shadowy cast of characters, including Dick Morris? And speaking of Dick Morris, that brings me to the next one, which I do have right here. It's called Armageddon, one of his more recent books, concerning his former bosses, Bill and Hillary. And he writes it with his wife, Eileen McGann. And for those of you who don't know, Dick Morris, he's kind of an amusing guy. He's also kind of an asshole, but you know, what are you going to do? The guy's like in his 60s or 70s. He's been through all the wars. He's kind of a funny character. He's on Fox News all the time. He's been on O'Reilly a lot. And he started out as a right winger, and he's never given up most of those ideas, which is kind of bizarre because he went to work for the Clintons, and one of his main roles, and that's what Christopher Hitchens talked about, and that's why Hitchens and Morris were kind of like oil and water. Hitchens came from the left side. He wanted Clinton to be more of a progressive candidate. The disappointment he had in Clinton as a progressive stemmed from Clinton's embrace of Dick Morris's advice, which was called triangulation. Triangulation, if you don't know, and Morris's book goes into a little about that. It talks about, it's like this. Bill Clinton got elected because of the support of A, the progressive left of the Democratic Party, but also the white working class voters among the Democratic Party voters, which had rejected the previous candidates, Mike Dukakis and Walter Mondale. And they'd gone and voted for Reagan and Bush. But they also had they weren't going to go for a candidate like Jesse Jackson, like Al Gore and Paul Tsongas, that were or Mario Cuomo. These guys were not going to be attractive to the rural white voters in these Midwestern and Southern and Western states. So Morris was giving Clinton a number of attack points where he was going to he was going to use the support of the left in order to maintain a front where he could draw on their support to fight through the media against the Republicans. On the other hand, he was going to use the Republicans' policies in order to steal their voters. And that's what he did when he did the welfare to work program, which Hitchens criticized immensely. That's what he did when he was doing things like showing up to church for a while every Sunday and showing his religious side, even though the Clintons are probably as distant from religion as any president has ever been, presidential couple. Dick Morris's book, though, it doesn't deal mostly with that. Armageddon is, I wouldn't recommend it. I'm going to show it to you again on screen. Armageddon is one of his more recent ones. I'm going to check out maybe some of his older ones from the 2000s. I'm not very impressed by the writing quality, for example. He makes a ton of mistakes. He cites a lot of internet sources, you know, just articles from the internet. Not that there's anything wrong necessarily, but it just looks like he put it together in kind of an amateurish way. Look, I mean, he does make the book a little entertaining, and he does have like the inside dirt on the Clintons, on some of their issues at working with them and their explosive temper, especially Hillary, and their propensity to lie. In this book, it discusses in passing, among other things, Clinton's lie that, or Hillary's lie that she was named after Sir Edmund Hillary, I think it was a New Zealander who he scaled Mount Everest. He was the first Westerner to scale Mount Everest. It turns out that that's complete bullshit, because Hillary scaled the mountain a few years after Hillary was born. Okay, so that doesn't make any sense. And there's another, I mean, this was a while ago. I think I read this in October or something. So I'd say there's a few details. If you like just straight up dirt, and you're not concerned about writing quality, if you're not concerned about necessarily scholarly standards, then Armageddon is a pretty good book. But I personally don't like it that much. And I'm going to move on to the next one. And this one is probably one of the more famous books of the past year. And I do recommend it both for the scholarly quality and the writing quality and the journalistic credentials. It's called Clinton Cash by Peter Schweizer. And this one is more geared towards people that are talking about the Clintons' activities since they left the White House. And, you know, it's sort of a good way to delve into their financial issues with the Clinton Global Initiative and the Clinton Family Foundation and the library and all the crap that they do in Haiti and everything. And they go into their donations from Gilbert Shaguri from Nigeria and this Canadian billionaire that is using them in order to get into mining concerns in Kazakhstan. It's a very Clinton Cash, take it from me, this would be the most useful book to kind of get into their current troubles. Their current troubles with the foundation, not necessarily with her email scandal. That would be, Edward Klein has a nice book on that I haven't read yet called Guilty as Sin. I haven't read that yet. I don't know whether you should read it. I've heard good reviews for it. The Clintons, they have had this pattern in their life where they believe that financial rules of donations and things like that, they don't really pertain to them, or even things that are unseemly but maybe legally permissible, that they just abuse it to the hilt. And they're always globetrotting and going around the world, and they're speaking fees and things like that, and even getting Chelsea speaking fees. Chelsea Clinton, who, by the way, I've kind of been mean to her during the campaign on the bold page, you know, because I do think she's kind of ugly. By kind of, I mean very ugly. But, you know, who am I? I'm not Fabio here. But look, Chelsea Clinton, whether you think I think she is an intelligent person, and I think she does have, you know, certain career qualifications. Then again, I don't know her personally. But to say that it's fair for her to charge a $65,000 speaking fee at a university, I think is like kind of ridiculous. So Clinton Cash, if you're looking for the financial dirt on them, that's a good place to go. Of course, there's other authors that talk about some of their earlier crap that they were doing. I think Barbara Olson, she has a book that I haven't read yet called Hell to Pay, and this was a writer who died in September 11th attacks, Barbara Olson, and so she's no longer with us. And that one talks a little more about her financial shenanigans in the 90s. So you could start from the 2000s, which a lot of people have been doing, or you could go even further. And when you go further back, you might get to this little gem. And I want to say this is so far, believe it or not, the best book I've read about the Clintons and their background ever. And it's not even necessarily just a Clinton book. This is by Jim McDougal with a co-author, Curtis Wilkie. Jim McDougal, if you haven't read about the Clintons, was Bill and Hillary's real estate partner in Whitewater, among other business interests. And he'd also worked for Bill Clinton for a while in the governor's office in Arkansas. And you have in Jim McDougal, you can read through his writing style. This is a real Arkansas character, and he weaves the stories of growing up there, and the folklore and the atmosphere of being in a state that was through and through loyal to the Democratic Party when he was growing up. And this is a person who he'd grown up working through the system of the Democratic Party in the South, which was segregationist, just like Clinton. And he started working for one of Arkansas's two senators. I think his name was John McClellan. He started out the Arkansas House and gradually worked his way up. He started working for John McClellan, who was a senator from Arkansas in the 50s and 60s. From there, he eventually got into the office of the other senator from Arkansas, J. William Fulbright, Bill Fulbright, who was considered Bill Clinton's mentor as far as politics were concerned during the 60s and 70s. And Bill Fulbright, if to get a context, Bill Fulbright and John McClellan were pretty much segregationists. They were not for integration of the schools for sure, or of any institutions. But at the time, they wielded immense power. They were Fulbright for sure was very well known in the U.S. Senate, and they carried a lot of power because at that time, one vote in the Senate, there were a lot of bills that were very close on many issues. And these were the Kennedy and Johnson years. So McDougal does talk a little about that. And so with McClellan, it wasn't so much relevant to Bill Clinton, but Bill Clinton was, McClellan was Fulbright's driver for one of his campaigns. And they used to argue in the car nonstop, and McClellan would, or Fulbright would pretty much get tired of Bill Clinton and storm off and say, you know, what the fuck is this, you know, young piece of shit, young pisser, what's this young blood talking to me about shit that I already know about? I've been a senator for decades. That was basically the attitude that Fulbright had. And you know, the Clintons and McDougals ended up becoming business partners in Whitewater, Susan and Jim McDougal. And there was also a bank that Jim McDougal opened in northwest Arkansas called Madison Guarantee and Trust in Madison, Arkansas, and Madison County, Arkansas, I think it is. And through that, you get an idea of some of the details, the early details that showed how the Clintons' character developed. And one of the details he reveals is that he knew about the cattle futures scandals that Hillary was doing. And he published this book while he was on his deathbed in the 90s, while he was in prison, in fact, for Whitewater, which he got convicted for and the Clintons got off free. And another thing is that he also revealed that Hillary Clinton claimed on her tax forms personal deductions for investments in Madison Guarantee and Trust, the savings and loan that they were both invested in, when in fact those were corporate deductions that she had no right to deduct. So she also, according to Jim McDougal, who remember he was a convicted felon, but according to him, she was a co-conspirator. And also she did cheat on her taxes. So you could take it for what it's worth. I tend to believe that a person who's dying and you know, he spent years and years working with these people. He was never convicted of perjury, for example. So it's kind of interesting that Hillary Clinton painted Donald Trump for the entire election cycle. Not that this is about Trump, but she was painting him as a tax cheat when her own business partner acknowledged that she did it back in the 80s. And she probably you could probably find a lot more evidence that she's been cheating on her taxes since then. So that's it for Arkansas Mischief, which I give the Five Leopards rating, which is an arbitrary rating that I've just made up now. So that's it for that. Another one that I finished a couple weeks ago is called Blood Feud by Edward Klein, the Clintons versus the Obamas. This one's pretty good, but it's also, like I said, if you want citations and ways to back up your facts, this isn't the one you want to look for. You could actually look for more in even Armageddon, but also in Arkansas Mischief, in Clinton Cash. Edward Klein relies a lot on insiders, but it turns out a lot of the allusions that he makes turn out to be correct. For example, the feud between Valerie Jarrett, who is Barack Obama's she's his Girl Friday. She's really the most powerful woman in the White House, probably even more powerful than Michelle Obama. In fact, I'm going to say this here because I might not remember it later. I think Valerie Jarrett might actually be a better candidate for public office than Michelle Obama. She has more, and I'll talk about it a different time, but she has a lot of the same you know, intelligence as President Obama. She's also African American. She comes from a very well-connected African American family from Chicago. And you know, this isn't the place to talk about, but Valerie Jarrett despised Hillary and Bill Clinton and couldn't stand them. And Blood Feud delves into a lot of the jealousy that was mutual between the Obamas and the Clintons. How, according to some sources, Obama couldn't stand Bill Clinton because he felt he was patronizing him, and he would come over to the White House on a few occasions when he was invited. Bill Clinton was basically hated by Barack Obama because he would start trying to give him advice and acting like the big dog and whatever. Other issues that were in hand, Bill Clinton also hated Obama, by the way. He thought that the guy was an amateur and a piece of shit, and he was ungrateful, and he didn't have any gratitude specifically for the Clintons for how they did help them during the 2008 campaign. And a lot of the book Blood Feud centers on the 2012 re-election of Barack Obama, which is a very interesting campaign. Personally, I thought that the Obamas really had a good chance of winning in either case, but apparently, due to their horrible first 4 years of just fucking everything up and not being able to pass any legislation besides Obamacare, the Obamas and their campaign manager, David Plouffe, were almost in crisis mode that they wouldn't be able to beat the Republican candidate. So Plouffe had a dispute with Valerie Jarrett where he said that in order to get reelected, he must use the most popular person in the Democratic Party at the time, who was Bill Clinton, more so than Hillary Clinton. And it was this sort of backdrop of the Obamas needing the Clintons in order to stay in the White House and the Clintons needing the Obamas in order to stay in the public light that makes the book pretty interesting. If it's all true, you know, again, I'm not coming here to tell you that every single book here, you know, Blood Feud, which you can tell is a little sensational title, I'm not here to tell you that those things should be taken as gospel, but you can see a lot of the traces that there's plenty of verified sources that the Clintons and the Obamas don't get along. Another thing that you have to consider along that track is that in 2012 and before that, I remember distinctly that there were rumors flying around a lot, and this was pretty frequent, that Hillary Clinton was going to run against Barack Obama for the Democratic Party nomination. Because she was already running through her last stage as a Secretary of State, and Obama's personal popularity was sinking at the time, and Hillary's wasn't as bad because Benghazi hadn't happened until September 2012. So it was a very interesting time, and the book does address to a degree how Bill Clinton was trying to drive her towards running against him, and then later to compromise and kind of use his talent in order to get Barack Obama to support her for the 2016 election, which according to this book, they don't necessarily do to the degree that we think they did. We think that the Obamas did support Hillary Clinton in her bid for the White House. Now, according to Edward Klein, it's not as simple, and that is the subject of a different book which I'm reading right now and I'm not going to review. This is called Unlikable by Edward Klein, and we'll talk about that a different time. And then the last two books I'm going to get to here, and we're running a little long, but that's the way it is. That's where most of my videos are. You have Crisis of Character, which is a pretty good book. It's by Gary Byrne, who was a former Secret Service uniform division officer. If you don't know what they are, you think of the black suit people. Those are the Secret Service agents. Those are the people who are the personal bodyguards of the president at all times. They'll follow them everywhere. Now, the uniform division, those are a little different. Those are the people stationed at locations like the White House, as they act as, just the security force within the White House grounds. It's a little different from the Secret Service agents. And Gary Byrne describes a lot of just interesting episodes and how he contrasts. This is a person, if you read the book, it's quite obvious from the get-go. He was very respectful of President Bush the Elder, George H.W. Bush. He felt that he was probably the best type of president. A very friendly guy, very social, very well behaved towards the Secret Service agents and the other people in the White House, and very, very respectful. And the Clintons, let's just say this, I'll put it lightly, he hated Hillary Clinton. Everybody hated Hillary Clinton. She would walk around and tell Secret Service agents to go fuck themselves in the morning if they would even greet her. He was one of those people that he was describing how, for example, Gary Aldrich, who was the FBI liaison to the president, even said that he confided in the Secret Service agents who did not, the Secret Service and the FBI, let's not get into this too much, but as with many of these services, the Secret Service and the FBI don't get along. But even then, the FBI liaison to the president, Gary Aldrich, confided in these Secret Service agents that Hillary was trying to use the FBI to spy on Bill's political opponents, and they refused. What's another detail? This is one I don't think I should spoil everything. Let's just say that he has a lot of details about the Monica scandal and everything, and how let's just say that the president, he was pretty much doing whatever he wanted, and he was lying about things even to his own staff about it. Okay, I'll give you one detail that I've been thinking about holding back. It seems that when he was done getting serviced by Monica Lewinsky, President Clinton would use the White House towels to clean himself off, and the White House steward, one of these Navy stewards that would basically be the president's butlers, would have to take these towels to laundry, and they would see on this towel with the presidential seal, they would see these stains, and one of them was obviously lipstick stains. Now, that, think about that for a second, lipstick stains on a towel. And then there was another more translucent stain on it. And these guys were out of their minds, because under President Bush and President Reagan, apparently neither of them had even stepped on the seal of the President of the United States in the Oval Office. They wouldn't even step on the seal on the, and this guy was taking the towels and President Clinton, and just using them as his personal wads or whatever. This was okay. Maybe did I get a little too graphic there? I'm sorry, but that I think was a. You should just read this book. It's kind of amazing, and Gary Byrne. That kind of gives you an idea. You have, and I'll get to this. The next person. This is the last book I'm going to read about. I'm going to give you a rundown about today. Look, you can say things about authors that have a vendetta against Hillary and Bill Clinton. People who actually served and worked with them, like Dick Morris, like Gary Byrne, who's this other guy? Jim McDougal, who was their business partner. I don't know if you could, can you really say, I mean, you Hillary supporters, if you're watching this, can you say you believe the Clintons, who one of them has been indicted for perjury, more than some of these people that have worked for them who have not been indicted for perjury yet, or so far as we know? That's a good question for you to ponder on the other side of this screen. Now, the last book, we're going to cut it short later. We're gonna try to get this done within 5 minutes, okay? Kathleen Willey, she wrote Target, Caught in the Crosshairs of Bill and Hillary Clinton. And this is a pretty good book. This is one of his sexual harassment accusers, Kathleen Willey. who she started out as a fundraiser for the Clintons during 1992 election, and again, I think she worked in some capacity for them in 1996, although not as much. And this is more of an account of the lying and the lack of ethics within the White House, and how she was personally groped by Bill Clinton on the day her husband disappeared, in fact, when she came to him for help. So far as we know today, her account is factual. The thing is that Bill Clinton's excuse was that he did not, that he apparently thought that her husband, that she was desperate and whatever after her husband died, and that's why he kind of moved in there to try to console her. It was some sort of weird bullshit story. The fact is that until a few days later, they didn't know that Kathleen Willey's husband had died in an apparent suicide. So Clinton's excuse was kind of bullshit. Later, during the hearings regarding the Lewinsky scandal, he also denied that he made phone calls to her during the 1992 campaign to get her to come over to his hotel. He denied that he made the phone calls. And he was confronted with phone records from his hotel. Remember, he was on the campaign. He was confronted with phone records that showed that he did. So that was one of the instances where you could say he was caught perjuring himself in court. Another issue that the Clintons had was their use of private detectives to harass her. The FBI does consider her story of harassment to have been true, because there is witness corroboration from people in her town. She lived in a very small town. There's witness corroboration that people were coming around and asking questions about her and her address and what she would buy and whatever. And these were private detectives. And there have been private detectives that, according to her, and according to press press articles by Mother Jones, among other ones, a progressive press outlet, they've interviewed private detectives that were hired in order to, putting it lightly, to investigate her, and according to her, to intimidate her. So that's it for today. This is the first edition of kind of a small series that I'm going to do. It might get longer. And look, if you have another book that you want reviewed about Bill and Hillary Clinton, I'm perfectly open to it. Look, I'm not saying that the other presidents aren't interesting, but what other presidents have used towels from the White House to wipe up their, you know, their little pleasure mess? I don't think you can name one. And until next time, it's Ramon. It's Ramon, and it's from Bold Like a Leopard. And this is the William J. and Hillary R. Rodham Presidential Penitentiary Library, first edition, and I hope you enjoy it as much as I do, even if there's not that many of you.